Parental discretion is advised.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Wrestling Mayhem Show 312. Yes, right here in Pittsburgh, PA, Mayhem Studios. I am Michael Sorg, Sorgatron, to my friends and enemies. With us over on the couch is Mr. Chachi.
Hi, guys.
Hi.
Hi, Chachi.
Says.net.
High five.
Insert coin to begin.com.
I just did a new story.
Yes.
So apparently, if you weren't at work this morning,
and I wasn't at work this morning,
you turned on your Xbox,
yeah,
you would have noticed that your gamer score was zero, and every achievement that you've ever earned since you hooked up the Xbox to Xbox Live was gone.
What?
Wait, hold on. I'm on there right
what?
Now.
What?
It's back now.
Okay.
But
I would have been very angry.
Yeah, every
My heart would have sank. I probably would have thrown up.
Yeah. yeah, they lost everything.
Oh my
and
God.
Had to restore it all.
Oh, and, so that's why I threw up.
And apparently any achievement that you earn during that time period is gonna take another 24 hours to show up because I have to fix that problem.
Okay.
So
thanks for that update.
You're welcome.
Chachi. And also coming to us.
Chachi, tell
what, hey!
Jesus Christ.
Damn it, Russell fan, you're fired!
DJ Lunchbox, MonsterHaiku.com, ThoughtfulRiot.com.
Hey, when am I getting my book?
Winner of Tetris Trophies.
That's right, Tetris, number two Tetris Trophy. You were getting your book very soon. We just got the printer's proof, and that is absolutely correct, Sorgatron. I am DJ Lunchbox, a.k.a. Alexander Hot Sauce, a.k.a. DJ Saucebox, a.k.a. Dick in the Ear McGee, a.k.a. the Art Nouveau Chewbacca, a.k.a. the very best of South by Southwest, the DJ Lunchbox, and I am back in healthy shipshape and Bristol fashion.
I'm glad.
My favorite one was DJ Sauce in the Box.
It's great seeing you, DJ Lunchbox. I'm glad to see your hysterectomy went well. Also joining us is the Wrestle Fan from now Corpus Christi, Texas. Is that where you're at?
I'm the Wrestle Fan. I can't follow that.
You
move on.
Fired.
All right, moving on. The Rizz. Oh, wait, that's not the Rizz.
That's not me.
That's not the Rizz.
That's not me.
What the hell?
Where am I?
You forgot to switch him.
I forgot to switch him. Hey, there's the Rizz. Hi, Rizz. I'm going to fix your camera while you say something awesome to introduce yourself.
Yeah.
No, wait.
What?
Where'd you go? High five.
Oh, hey.
High five.
Hey. There we go.
Listen.
That was almost well-timed.
Rizz can say whatever he wants, and I guarantee that it's not going to be as good as DJ Sauce in the Box. I'm sorry. I like Rizz. I'm a huge fan of Rizz, but it's tough to beat DJ Sauce in the Box.
Penis.
No, I'm sorry.
That didn't work.
No,
didn't work.
Moving on.
Awesome. Moving on. Well enough. This is, of course, the Wrestling Mayhem Show. Go check out everything we got going on.
And you are?
Oh, wait, who am I? How already introduced myself?
I don't know.
It's the master of ceremonies.
DJ Dick in the Ear.
Anyways,
Sorgatron.
You guys can go over to WrestlingMayhemShow.com. Check out everything that's going on there. I'm just moving on with that. That is okay. You can go also check out our Twitters at Mayhem Show. We are on the Facebooks. We like to converse with you. Just look up Wrestling Mayhem Show. We're in a couple different places over there. You can also drop us a line at our email.
Good times
at WrestlingMayhemShow.com. Or you can come drop us a line at 412-206-WMS0. Chachi, take it away.
9670.
Oh, yeah, with the funk. You can also look us up on your Wrestling Mayhem Show app on your iTunes App Store or on your Google Play Store. Is that what it is now?
Yeah, it is. Yeah, it's
switched
over.
Thing?
Yeah,
it
switched over.
It's $1.99.
You get $1.99.
Exclusive footage. Yeah. What?
Yeah.
And all the connections, all the episodes, all the connections to communicate with the show directly there in your app. It's also, on the Kindle App Store for the Kindle Fire and Android devices as well. Excuse me. Wow.
You want to hear stuff that you don't hear on the show? $1.99 will get you that.
There you go. There you go. And, of course, we like to start our shows off fresh off the presses with some emails. Let's take it first to Sonic Screwjob has an email. Take it away. Somebody. Rizz, I believe is having
Rizz? This. Rizz? Give it to Rizz.
Okay.
Go, Rizz.
Go, Rizz.
Shut up. Salutations, Mayhem. As WrestleMania looms closer, I have all but relinquished any hopes of keeping up with TNA. So I'll just drop a couple opinions of Raw. I'm not a big fan of gimmicked Raws. The only exception to my rule would probably be the Raw Roulette. And a huge example of my distaste would be the rocking, rapping, reeking Raw from last night. Wow. The actual in-ring action was great, but the rapping and the rocking segments was as compelling as watching grass grow. Is it just me, or does Cena and The Rock remind you of two of you guys of the Looney Tune where Daffy is trying to win an audience over from Bugs while with singing and dancing until finally gives in, blows himself up by drinking nitroglycerin.
He's right.
He is right. And this time the nitroglycerin is queen.
Mm-hmm. Yep. It's just a sad case of two guys trying too hard. Yeah. Since I'm prone to soapboxing, I just have to comment on the CM Punk Jericho storyline. Stop it. Stop this Dr. Phil pop psycho donkey scat right now.
Wow.
If I wanted a story about struggle and overcoming the shadows of addiction to win the hearts and minds of your colleagues and the eventual love of a father gripped in his own inner turmoil, I would just turn to the Lifetime channel or watch a very special episode of Blossom, or maybe The Facts of Life. You know, the episode where Natalie starts drinking to fit in with the popular kids when all she needed to do was just let people see her true beauty.
That's not true. That's not true. Natalie was right to drink. She was a terrible person, and alcohol is the only way that she would be pretty.
Whoa.
Wow.
I'm just putting it out there. All right?
Oh, man. I'm going to the scoreboard.
Want me to keep going while you're...
Yeah, keep going.
Okay. Sorry. Maybe I'm showing too much. Anyway, don't louse the best match on the card with a boatload of honey emotional hooey.
What? Wait,
boatload of emotional
boatload hooey. Of emotional hooey.
Hooey.
I said hooey.
Hooey.
H-O-O-E-Y.
Go with it.
Let me guess. Next week, CM Punk will show up on Raw with the corpse of Jericho's hamster that his parents told him ran away to live on a farm when he was seven. Okay. That would probably be cool, but they had the perfect setup. Two colossal egos on a collision course because they just need to know who is the better man. Just let it happen. Don't go all TNA on about it. Let set the stage and let the talent tell the story. Have a great show, Sonic Screwjob. P.S. Props to Sheamus for the hit he took on the announce table. That was a nasty bruise. The way he shows marks, they really should make a Sheamus Doodle Bear.
That'd be hilarious. Awesome. Awesome. Wow. And this one definitely goes to DJ Lunchbox for the next one.
I do know that. Yes.
Yes, you do. Oh, my God.
The title of this email is Fuck What You Say. That Shit's Cray.
Oh, no.
What's good, WMS crew? Yesterday was a great moment for Cleveland in the Quicken Loans Arena, and all it had to do with wrestling, because it sure as hell had nothing to do with those sad-ass Cavaliers, who are 16 and 23. The Rock and John Cena threw some powerful shots at each other, but I'm rooting for the People's Champion. And if you don't like it, fuck what you say. Wait, no.
You alright?
Yeah, I heard the music.
You're getting the beat.
I'm getting your music.
Yeah.
John Cena versus The Rock is a matchup, and the feud is so well done that the line between real and fake are constantly blurred. The reason I'm cheering for The Rock is because John Cena is a pussy, and here's why. For those new to the WWE, The Rock was still around when Cena was coming up, but there was no beef. Rock chooses to retire, and there is still no beef. Cena becomes the man, joins Raw, and sells out his favorable character for the bland fucker we know now. Now, on top, Cena starts shit by going on an interview and talking about The Rock. This ungrateful fucker says The Rock needs to stop saying he loves the wrestling business if he always in Hollywood and only comes back for non-wrestling appearances. No one calls out Cena for his ignorance, but the hate is spread onto the internet, and the bitter Cena is born. Excuse me. Fast forward to 2012. Beef materializes into a wrestling feud, and Johnny B. Bland is out to crucify The Rock for leaving wrestling and not coming back. Wait, so John Cena attacks The Rock for retiring and going on to other things in life? The Rock was on top of the world when he was on top. Yep, that's what it says. And rightfully so, the people's champ. But after being on top for so long, it's obvious you have to come down. The Rock decided to go to Hollywood and the fans were crushed, but he left us a legacy and standard. So the fuck what he left? Michael Jordan retired twice from basketball, but there was no doubt that MJ loved basketball. Rocky was born in the business, grew up on it, paid his dues, and went out on top. Why? In this era, are the younger guys shitting on the older ones? What's next for John Cena, you ask? Stone Cold Steve Austin. Somebody tell Cena that his movies all suck, and if he wants real fans, he better watch The Rock very closely. I'm having trouble talking tonight. But then again, what do I know? I'm just a gritty-ass New York ninja that can't wait for the Heat in the playoffs, Peyton to choose a team, and the Knicks to force Jeremy Lin to play off the bench. And if you don't like it, fuck what you say!
And as usual, aside from this music that we've been hearing, there are several pictures. You want to go?
Yes, indeed.
Such as Die Bitch with SpongeBob. SpongeBob, yeah.
Sonic SpongeBob.
And there's a picture of some like young child's homework that says it's a woman saying a math problem, and it says Tracy is wrong. Use an example to show that Tracy is wrong, and the reply is she is a woman.
Oh my! And I wow.
It's not right.
Okay, we're skipping that one. Let's see. Hey, brother, do you think there's life after Booth? Do you believe in Mom? Nah, I don't believe these things. I'm an atheist. I mean, have you ever seen Mom? red and blue, don't make orange. That's a joke, you idiot. Wow. So, the visual stylings of one. The Wolf.
I disagree with everything that he said in that email.
We don't agree with it.
It was very interesting to get a new, fresh perspective on this.
It is. Yeah. Definitely. So now I'm saying it.
Also, if you do disagree with him, I think I can speak for him and go ahead and say, fuck what you say.
I got Bobby's email.
Oh, you did?
I'm reading Bobby's email.
No, you're not.
Yes, it's for the indie minutes.
Yeah, well, this week, Chachi is covering this.
Sorg, Sorg. No, no.
Mute him.
Chachi, WrestleFan sounds like he's like shouting at his computer from another room.
I think we let him have it. WrestleFan, let's start off with you.
In the minute for this. So first of all, I'm going to mention sort of news coming out from a big indie wrestling DVD distributor, and that's SmartMark Video. They announced that this week they will be creating a video-on-demand service, which will feature shows from the companies that they already released DVDs for, but also they will be featuring iPay-per-views, so they're getting into that sort of business of iPay-per-views. I don't believe the website has been launched yet, but it's definitely going to be interesting to see how that comes about and how SmartMark Video runs with that whole new, regime, you could say.
Why are we saying regime?
Well, it's not regime. What's market?
New market. There you go. That works.
That's the word, market. Okay. So now talking, sort of going into, you know what, Sorg and Chachi, you two can take this one because you were at IWC this weekend.
Hey, we were, Chachi.
I was.
You were.
I was there.
You were. Chachi, do you have any tidbits Ringside. That you enjoyed? Is there anything? Well, we talked a little bit about it on Gold, about Jason Gorey's interesting Spider-Man moves. But was there anything else that you wanted to point out from the IWC?
Logan Shulo is the champ!
Shulo! Yes, he is!
Norm Connors came back to IWC for a night.
Mm-hmm.
Because Jimmy DeMarco has been all, fuck what you say to the fans and to Chuck Roberts, and so Norm came back, and Jimmy was all, oh, well, Norm's on my side, and Norm came out and set him up, had a ref shirt on, was getting ready to count, and screwed him out of the belt, and basically Norm counted Shulo for the 3 count, Chuck Roberts came out and agreed with Norm's decision. So, we have a new IWC champion in Logan Shulo.
Shulo.
Heavy metal Jesus.
Yes. What else?
It was a good show. It was a fun show.
Yeah, overall, it was a fun show. Learned some new things about camera techniques.
Oh, yeah.
Jason Gorey is Spider-Man.
Listen to Gold for that one.
Yeah. But no, it was a good show overall. All the matches were well done.
Excellent. Yeah, it was a great show. DVD's already available, of course, on SorgatronMedia.com.
Buy it now and see my work.
There's a teaser you'll see here at the break after the interview here in a little bit, so go check that out. Yes, Joshy. Yeah, and it's mostly your shots in there once again.
Oh, yeah, that's because I get shit done.
Wow.
I get the good shit.
Yes.
Chachi brings the money shots, yo.
There's an email from Bobby FJ Town.
Yes.
And Chachi wanted to read some indie stuff. We're bringing it on slowly.
I did.
Yes, what's going on?
Gentlemen, it's time for another edition of the AON fucking DVR recorded a damn infomercial. And that concludes the AON report. Bobby FJ Town. P.S. I miss Manchild.
Wait, I have to ask though.
Yes,
Bobby, if you're listening,
he is.
Please tell us what the infomercial was, because maybe I would like to buy that.
Shake weight.
Shake weight.
Yeah. Shake weight.
Shake weight. Work on your hand jibbers.
Or the ninja blender thingy.
Probably shake weight.
Yes, WrestleFan. Anything else coming at you?
That's all the news I have for this week in indie wrestling.
Oh, but so, you, yes, and yeah, with that, that let's with that let's take it to the interview with Biss. Take it away, WrestleFan.
Right now, here on the phone lines, we are here with Justin Bissonnette, aka Biss, from Anarchy Championship Wrestling. How are you doing tonight, Biss?
Very good. What is up, yins? Did I use that right? I got that one.
That's right. That's right. You
did research.
It's proper dialect and everything.
Actually, I was pretty pumped to hear you guys were based out of Pittsburgh. My family's actually from Pittsburgh, so I got quite a few ties to Pittsburgh.
Nice.
So we'll, just the kind of question that we kind of start off most of our interviews with. So what's your first memory of professional wrestling? How did you sort of get into loving professional wrestling?
Oh, wow. My first memory of professional wrestling was actually WrestleMania 8. I think I watched it before that, but my first vivid memory was WrestleMania 8 and Piper versus Bret Hart.
Nice.
Would probably be the first thing that sticks out in my head. I don't know. I think my parents watched it. So, you know, I watched it and was just kind of aware of it and kind of caught the fever like that.
Cool. Very cool. We mentioned Anarchy Championship Wrestling on the show before. You are the lead play-by-play commentator for that. How did you get started for ACW? Because I hear that you started going to shows as a fan.
Yeah, I did. Late 2005, December of 2005, early 2006, I got laid off from my job and had some free time. So me and a roommate of mine went to meet and greet with Mick Foley, who was like an idol of mine, some seedy ballroom at a local hotel. And it was like $20 to get in, $20 to take a piss, $20 to like stand in line for the autograph, and then you had to like buy something. So it was a miserable experience, like meeting my idol that way. And there were flyers for the local wrestling shows, and we actually we got one of the flyers and went to the show, and that's kind of started going to shows as fans. And I actually started training in November of 2006 to be a wrestler.
Oh, really? So that was sort of your first like move into sort of the wrestling business.
Yeah, well, I trained for about a month, and kind of I got to the point where I realized I was not going to be able to become the best in the world. You know, I was just going to be a dude that wrestled. And I didn't want to do that. You know, there were plenty of guys that just, you know, showed up and did that. So I actually thought I was done at that point. I was like, it's not going to work out. I'm just going to move on. And I started, there's a website down here called IndieWars.com, IndieWarsRadio.com. Stan Callahan with Indie Wars Radio actually asked me to help him out with some of the people that were coming to ACW. To do interviews and stuff like that, just for his radio station. He wanted to do like this video on demand stuff that never really took off. But, I interviewed Nigel McGuinness at the second, ACW show. And, shortly after that, the IndieWars, TV.com or whatever it was at the time kind of, you know, went belly up. And Darren Childs, who owns ACW, basically said, well, why don't you just come do this stuff for us? And that was my first foot in the door with ACW.
Cool. And so you've been working with them for definitely a good while. For those that don't know, if you could describe what Anarchy Championship Wrestling is all about, how would you describe it?
We're a bunch of kids, man. We're trying to be ECW basically, and you know, we're trying to do our own thing. But when it boils down to it, we're a bunch of kids that loved the old ECW, and we're trying to do new things. Like that's obviously a big part of what we do, is to be different and stick out. But we like that old ECW feel.
I think that
kind of sums us up.
Yeah, I've been to a good amount of your shows, and it is very ECW-esque, but I definitely think that you guys have a lot of aspects that weren't there in like the old ECW that really do sort of make you guys better and sort of become and make you guys definitely one of the top in Texas.
Yeah, I think a big part thing difference that you would see would be the American Joshi Division. We've really kind of, with Rachel Summerlin being so involved in the ownership, women's wrestling kind of come to the forefront. And, you know, we do a lot of stuff like that. So.
Yeah. And I heard you had a good say into sort of the development of the American Joshi Division.
What was that? Sorry.
That you kind of sort of helped sort of develop in a way the what the American Joshi Division sort of became.
Well, yeah, I mean, we when early on, you know, we would when we would have women's matches, you know, the cliche thing would be, you know, it's time for some girl on girl action or something like that. But you know, I just personally didn't feel comfortable with that type of stuff. So I actually stole it from Allison Danger. She cut a promo about the pride and fight of the American Joshi. So, you know, instead of a little bit of girl on girl action, it's all right. It's time for a little bit of American Joshi action. And it just kind of, it took off from there. And I'm a big fan of Japanese Joshi. So, any input I could have on that end, of course, I threw in my 2 cents.
Yeah. And it's really developed into something that you guys, I think, definitely have become it, not just in Texas, but like in general, one of the top female wrestling companies. You know, every year you put on the ACW American Queen of Queens tournament, which I'm also hopefully planning on going to this year. I'm definitely very excited for that. Well, you bring in a lot of big names in the women's wrestling world. So it definitely has developed just from just being, you know, a women's match on a show to being probably one of the top divisions in America.
Yeah, it's been a fun ride too, because I mean, even for us in 2007, there were, if you had girls on the show, there were 2 girls and that was 1 match, you know?
Right.
So it was really cool to at that time there's probably 5 girls in Texas that were competing at a high level, but they weren't competing against each other. So just to bring them all together and see what it turned into has been really cool.
Very cool. Yeah. If you can think of like, your favorite ACW moment, or maybe like your favorite match that you called, what do you think sort of like sticks out in your mind in the time that you've been in ACW?
Oh, but man, it's hard to nail it down like that. Tozawa versus ACH was very special for me. I was there the night that ACH found out that he was going to be wrestling Tozawa, so that was very special. ACH versus Chris Hero was a lot of fun. I got to call a match with Colt Cabana, which was personally very cool for me. A match that actually wasn't that good, but just special for me. I called a match with Bryce Rensburg.
Oh, really? Yeah.
I guess I would have to say, minus the nasty aspects, the ACH winning the Lone Star Classic was pretty special.
Yeah, you guys definitely have, like one of the things that sort of stuck out with me when I started going to ACW shows is you guys do, like as far as independent wrestling shows go, you do an amazing job with storytelling. It's not, you know, sort of like, in independent wrestling, I think that aspect is still very lost, but you guys definitely bring it out into the forefront and do a lot of great stuff. I just got finished watching your Guilty by Association 5 event with Robert Evans against Matthew Palmer, and that match, watching ACW for that long, you could still feel the drama, and it's something that you could sort of get involved with without knowing a lot of the backstory and still have sort of like a vested interest in.
Yeah, and that's something I really can't kind of wrap my head around, because the most fun part about wrestling is the storylines and the storytelling. That was a big part when I thought I was just going to be done with wrestling. And, at the end of 2006 was I would go to the local shows before as a fan, and every show kind of reset, it seemed like. So when ACW came along and, started doing more of the storyline driven stuff, it was like, wow, finally, you know?
Yeah.
So, and that was before, May 6th was 2007 was when I got involved, so that was kind of, you know, my viewpoint before I actually got involved with the company.
Mm-hmm. Here's sort of a fun question for those fans listening out there and all that kind of stuff. If you could pick the one, because I know you have like a revolving set of people that you commentate with on shows. Who do you think would be your favorite person to commentate with?
We talk about this all the time. I have to give you three names. I can't give you one. Sean Vex, I have a blast calling matches with, because it's basically like we're sitting in the living room drinking beer. Just talking about wrestling.
And you also manage Sean Vex in another company in Texas, if I'm correct.
Yeah, or I think I'm supposed to. I haven't managed him in about a year, but yeah, that's a funny story. I'll remind me to talk about that, and I'll get into that. That's kind of funny. The other one is Robert Evans. Another part of my job is actually scouting talent and bringing in new talent for ACW. And I actually first found Robert Evans through commentary he did for a company called No Limit Pro Wrestling, which lasted like three shows, but he was just incredible. So I kind of selfishly wanted to bring him in just to be able to have someone to do commentary with. And, of course, that kind of blossomed into something much, much larger. But Robert Evans, I always have a lot of fun with. And I almost hate to admit it publicly, but I love calling matches with Gary J.
Oh, that was one of my personal favorites I was going to point out there.
Yeah, I have way too much fun calling with Gary J.
Mm-hmm. And you mentioned sort of, and you guys are the top in Texas, definitely ACW. If you think of Texas companies, you definitely are one of the top. But you guys are you're more than just a Texas wrestling company. You guys have expanded out into not just the best in Texas, but one of the best in the U.S. You guys, you know, being on Smart Mark Video, and you also expanding out to like your subgroup, St. Louis Anarchy. So do you think you consider yourself more a Texas company or sort of more just a U.S.-based independent company?
From day one, our goal was always to, you know, we wanted to compete with Chikara and Pro Wrestling Guerrilla, and at the time, IWA, Mid-South. Our goal was never really to be the best in Texas. Our goal was to be, you know, one of the top indie promotions in the United States. So, there was a point in time where we weren't the best company, you know, in Texas. It didn't take us long to get there, in my opinion. But there, you know, we were shooting higher than that, though. Because there's kind of a, if that's all that you're shooting for, once you get there, you know, you kind of stagnate and you just kind of stop there. So, you know, our goal is always going to be on top of the Smart Mark Video sales and to be, you know, we want to be the best independent promotion in America, in North America, you know.
Definitely. This kind of goes to like my next question I wanted to ask, because the stars of ACW are sort of becoming more known to the mass public. Guys like ACH, who's getting a lot of opportunities now in other companies. Rachel Summerlin, who just came off winning that big 2CW women's tournament in New York. Robert Evans, who's now on ROH and Chikara and stuff like that. My question is, because I've been going to ACW for a little while, and I see I don't think there's one bad talent on your roster. And there's definitely a lot of potential with all those guys, but it is kind of I wouldn't say sad in a way, but kind of it just when you I talk about these sort of talents, but there's a good majority of people that don't know a lot about, say, guys like Scott Summers or Jacob Pliskin or, you know, some of the top guys in ACW. My question is, do you think that people should venture out past like the region that they're known for? And go to like, say, maybe to like the East Coast or the Midwest or stuff like that and get, you know, get some spots there? Or do you think people can sort of build a reputation in sort of their local region?
It's kind of hard for me to answer that, but it's not to. to represent Texas, and I'm a Texas guy. I love Texas. I love Texas wrestling. And I want Texas wrestling to be the best. I want us to overtake Philly, you know. But for that to happen, our guys have to go out and show the world how good they are. So you can't just do that staying in Texas. You have to get out. You have to show the world how good you are. And then hopefully you come back home, you know. Recently, you know, Texas produces a lot of talent, but they're not really doing it in Texas, you know. They show their talents, and then they're gone, you know. So yes and no, I guess, is the answer.
Yeah, because, I mean, I just think about it because with guys like Scott Summers, who have, you know, made that reputation to be, like, the top pro wrestler in Texas right now, I would love to just see, like, them going to, like, an audience where, you know, I get to see them on even, you know, a bi-weekly basis, but, you know, other people don't get that opportunity to.
Yeah, and I would love to see Scott Summers in CZW. I mean, if you've seen enough of his tape, you cannot tell me he would not thrive in that environment.
From what I know, he has done stuff in like Japan and stuff like that.
Yeah, he's done Big Japan earlier in his career. He was part of AAA in Mexico. Not a lot of people know that part of his career. So he was out there in AAA and didn't really get the recognition. I would love to see Scott Summers travel a lot more. So if I can leave that one at that.
Yeah, definitely. So kind of in sort of a way with that, who do you think are the stars in ACW that people should look out for or people should, you know, keep an eye on?
I think JoJo Bravo is going to be amazing. I really do. I think Bolt Brady is incredibly talented, and Jordan Jensen is a guy that wants it. I'd like to see him put it all together. And Matthew Palmer is another guy that is probably at that point where he can venture out, you know. So it's just a question of whether or not he's going to do that. So.
Because, I think ACW is that company that really does make a lot of stars. Like, from ACA to, I believe, started with you guys in, like, 2009, and now he's getting opportunities in, like, AIW in Cleveland. He's working CZW Best of the Best this year. I believe he's also working for Resistance Pro, which is Billy Corgan's Fed. So I definitely see ACW as, like, the company that sort of makes people.
Yeah, and that's kind of that was the goal all along. We want to build people up, and then for them to go out and show their talent, and hopefully people will see an ACH match at IAW or CZW Best of the Best Mojo. They'll look him up, and that'll bring people back to ACW. It doesn't hurt ACW that ACH is out showing his talents, you know. The same thing goes for Rachel Summerlin, Athena, you know, Robert Evans too.
Definitely. One of the things I wanted to discuss, because it's a couple months away. One of the events that ACW holds that I'm most excited for is definitely your prom event, something that I've never experienced before. And you only started doing the actual prom theme last year. Do you want to tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, I'll come clean right here. Me and head of production, Rufus D. Jones, sat in a car after hearing, you know, we're going to do a wrestling prom, just like hands in our head, like, what are they thinking? You know, we're ACW, damn it. You know, how the hell are we going to, we're going to do a wrestling prom, you know? And, you know, I started to buy into it, but, you know, the day of the show, I was still, man, this could go bad, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And, after the show, I was 100% sold. Like it was amazing. I don't know if you guys have seen the prom show on DVD, but I was amazed at how well it came out. I was probably one of the biggest skeptics.
So. Yeah, and it was definitely something that, you know, it doesn't, when you think of ACW, it may not necessarily fit in, but it does, in a way it does, because it just fits your sort of, I guess, the style in a way. Like, I know a lot of people were very receptive and sort of on the fence because you were ACW was going to do a six-woman evening gown match.
We put Sarah Del Rey in an evening gown match. How dare we? You know?
Yeah. There were
people that were very upset at us, you know. But, you know, And that's what the American Joshi Division is all about. Like, that match there embodies it together. You can put them in any situation, and they're going to perform as wrestlers, you know?
Right.
So.
Yeah, and, like, from what I've seen of it, it's not what you think of when you think of an evening gown match. It's
no, we shattered that, man.
So, yeah, definitely.
That was a home run. All six of those girls, you know, deserve amazing props. They hit a home run that night.
Mm-hmm. So definitely, I'm definitely looking forward to going to that event. But you guys have an event coming up this weekend, in Live Oak, Texas, that wanted to go over a little bit. Very big event. A lot of first time matchups on this card.
Yeah, it's going to be a big chance for young talent to shine. Our last event, we had a couple injuries that mm-hmm. you know, kind of sets the stage for people to step up, you know. So
definitely headlining with for the first time Masada, who just came off winning the CZW heavyweight title. He's going to be facing Jerry Lynn. So that's definitely going to be a match to see.
Yeah, and that's a match that when Jerry went back to TNA to do the hardcore reunion or whatever it is that they called it, we actually had that match booked back then, and you know, due to the TNA dates, it got scrapped. Uh-huh. So, it was something that we always wanted to do, and you know, finally the dates matched up, and we were able to present it. You know, March 18th.
And it definitely got a lot of implications behind it, especially Jerry Lynn announcing a week ago that he's going to end his career at the end of 2012. So there's definitely going to be a lot on the line in that matchup.
Yeah, and you know, we call Jerry Lynn the Godfather of Anarchy. Going back to the ECW references, Jerry Lynn is our Terry Funk. You know,
mm-hmm.
he is that guy that's a mentor to almost everyone that's in that locker room. So, you know, that just kind of adds, I guarantee you every member of that locker room will be lined across the balcony to watch that match.
Definitely. You have a lot of good matchups here too. ACH defending against Matt Fitchett, who I'm definitely excited for that match, because I definitely think Fitchett is one of those guys that could definitely, come up to be, one of the top stars in ACW. I think it may be his year.
Yeah. How did I miss Matt Fitchett and, future stars? Like, that kid is amazing. He's from the St. Louis territory, which brought us Evan Bourne and Delirious. And, you know, he's right in that same mold. So yeah, I'm pumped to call this match as well. So, mm-hmm. I'm just hoping St. Patty's Day is the night before. So I'm hoping, he comes in at least less hungover than I will be.
Yeah. and then, of course, you got a lot of other great stuff coming up for that event. Yeah, like you said, the American Joshi stuff, Rachel Summerlin against Angel Blue. That's definitely going to be a great match to see. Evangelistico and Robert Evans, first time ever. So.
Yeah, that's going to be hard for me to call with the Evan versus Evans, but I'm sure I'll fight through it. But, yeah, that Evangelistico is another guy that's really carried the torch for St. Louis Anarchy, and you know, is a guy that not a lot of people know about that is extremely talented.
Very cool. So that event's definitely going to be a really great show. Just to sort of promote it a little bit, March 18th in Live Oak, Texas. You can still get your tickets, I believe, at anarchychampionshipwrestling.com. So go check them out. You can see me. I'll be there. Biss will be there. So. It's definitely going to be a great night of professional wrestling.
Yeah, hopefully you can avoid some ACHs this time around. I think it'll come back into play.
Yeah, definitely. So, well, thank you, Biss, for I can't talk tonight. Thank you for coming on to the show. Great interview. Like I said, at BissACW on Twitter, so go follow this guy. He's got a lot of great stuff to say about the stuff that goes on.
Yeah, I run off at the mouth way too much, but thank you guys very much for having me. It was my pleasure.
Thanks, WrestleFan, for that great interview with Biss. Go check out AnarchyChampionshipWrestling.com. If not, just for the ladies. No, I'm a real big fan of that, what they're doing down there with the women's wrestling from what I've seen on the YouTube and everything. And yeah, sounds like you're having a lot of fun down there, WrestleFan.
Indeed.
So with that, let's go check out a little bit what's going on with Gold. And take a little bit of a look at the latest release, as we mentioned earlier, from SorgatronMedia.com. And we'll be right back with Remember When. Or is fucking Donatello in the shower.
But,
that's
yeah,
weird. But, that's weird. That's wow. weird.
Jason Gorey is fucking Donatello in the shower.
It's but really I have.
Signed by.
Signed by the network.
No, I get a lot of like notifications. Hey, we just identified that you have IOTA stuff in your video. No shit! You told us to do it! But the boss is back!
I don't own this anymore! I've got no liability! That means I can do whatever the heck I wanted to.
A yard for a foot or an inch, yeah, I fight for you all, is the truth, and I'm in, yeah, I fight for every breath that I take, and I fight for every step that I make.
Oh, no,
is life or death, winning or losing is the difference. You are the witness, inches around us, every second decisions. Too slow, and I missed it, fast, and I skipped it, but I'm on.
That's North Hunter! Will he live up to that promise? No trapping!
What's up, guys? This is DJ Lunchbox of the Wrestling Mayhem Show. I am at the exclusive screening of Death From Above, the new Kurt Angle film, and I'm here with JR, who played Easy in the movie, and he was absolutely the runaway hit of the movie. The best part, him and Matt Morgan, and I say that with no bias whatsoever. Now, how did you get involved with the movie?
They noticed the monster truck that I have and stuff and asked if I could have the monster truck in the movie. And then at the, some point it became that I had a character and became a character in it.
Excellent. Very cool. Now, did you enjoy the whole filming process?
Yeah. Yeah, I thought it was a fun thing to do. Was a lot of hours involved, but it was fun. It was a lot of long hours at night and into the middle of the night, but it was fun, definitely.
Cool. Now, would you come back for a sequel, for a Death From Above 2?
Yeah, I think that would be a fun thing to do. I think it would be a fun thing for the truck and everything. Mm-hmm. It exposes the truck. It's actually gets the truck out there. More people see it.
Mm-hmm. Now, what kind of, is it a specific kind of truck or?
It's a ride truck. We use it for doing kid rides, birthday parties, and actually in this film we took the seats out and put the roll bar back in it just to do the film. But right now it has the seats back in it, and we do birthday parties and stuff.
Cool. Do you have a website or anything like that?
No, we don't really have a website for the truck, but we do have the Longhorn Corral, which is also in the movie, is actually a bar and restaurant that we have, and we have Facebook. That's okay. Facebook. Oh, yeah. I couldn't think of what she takes care of here, but yeah, Facebook.
Where's the Longhorn at?
The Longhorn Corral. It's up on Route 422, just right outside of Butler. If anybody's familiar with the Big Butler Fair, we're just down from the Big Butler Fair, about a mile. And that's one of our main places that we do a lot of the rides for the truck, too, during the fair. And actually, just today, the fair, one of the board members called me and make sure we had it coming again this year. So that'll be in July.
Cool. Very cool. Well, thank you for joining us here on the Wrestling Mayhem Show. And again, just the best part of the movie.
Thank you so much.
Appreciate it.
This comes along and splat. Roadkill.
What's up, hot dogs? This is DJ Saucebox back again on the Wrestling Mayhem Show. I'd like to take you on a little Journey of the Mind. And a little segment we like to call Remember When. Year 1994. The event, SummerSlam. There was a main event to end all main events. One of the finest matches ever wrestled in the World Wrestling Federation as it was known then. But no, we will get to that. Let's start with the dark match. A clash of the Titans. He was big. He had long hair. He wore goggles. His name, Adam Bomb. In a time unknown by man nor beast, he defeated the strange warrior from the east, Quang. Remember him? Nobody really does. So we have our opening match, a nice tag team match. IRS and Bam Bam Bigelow, strange bedfellows, sure, defeated the Head Shrinkers, Fatu and Samu, with Afa and Lou Albano, won by disqualification. Why not? my greatest memory of the Head Shrinkers is an old WWF magazine that showed one of them eating with SpaghettiOs out of a raw fish. Second match, actually, you know, quite good. We had Alundra Blaze, the women's champion at the time, versus Bull Nakano, which nobody knew who the fuck she was, but she was fat and she was Japanese, and that made her a bad person. In a strange twist, Razor Ramon, being managed by Walter Payton, of all people, beat Diesel for the Intercontinental Championship. Diesel, on his early run with Shawn Michaels, back before he turned on him, Big Daddy Angry. Tatanka defeated Lex Luger in a match I'm sure no one ever remembers. Jeff Jarrett, that's right, Double J, Jeff Jarrett defeated Mabel, a.k.a. Viscera, a.k.a. whatever the hell he called himself towards the end of his career. Best not to remember him either. Thank God he's gone. It is worth pointing out that he was being managed by Oscar, so this was on the tail end of the Men on a Mission days. That's right. That was almost the main event. Next up was Bret Hart versus Owen Hart in a steel cage. Absolutely famous match. Bret Hart had like walking pneumonia. He was half dead. He had this amazing match with Owen. Great match, but that's not what I'm talking about. That's not why I remember SummerSlam 1994, because that wasn't even the main event. The main event. Magic. In one corner, you had the Dead Man, the Undertaker. He had been on a rampage throughout the WWF, defeating the Brooklyn Brawler and any other jobber they could put on WWF Superstars on Saturday morning, which I would watch all the time because I was young at the time. The face was his opponent at SummerSlam, the very event that he debuted at. Who was it? It was the Undertaker. But in purple, which makes it different. They burned the house down. 8 minutes! 8 minutes and 57 seconds! That is almost 9 minutes of the best wrestling that has ever happened on the planet. Of course, the new and purple Undertaker was victorious. I'm sure he used the power of the urn. And three, that's right, folks, three tombstones, which, if I remember correctly, is one tombstone more than it took to defeat Shawn Michaels. Look at that footage. Look at it. Undertaker versus Undertaker. Never been a match to rival it since. Dave Meltzer gave it 12 stars. He pissed tears. He was so excited about the glory of this match. It was absolutely amazing. It changed my life. I know it changed yours. And that, my dear friends, is why I bring it up this week here on Remember When.
DJ Lunchbox, all your questions and memories are completely questionable. I just want to say that.
DJ sauce in the box.
I must add, I keep on saying it every time it's brought up, that match was the first match I've watched as a kid.
And well done.
So to Rizz, it was the greatest thing ever.
Yes.
And you continued watching wrestling after this?
continued watching.
Wow.
It was the greatest and best match that's ever happened.
High five.
High five. Bang.
On that note, hey, we're going to toss it over to...
DJ Sauce in the Box.
No, we're going to say... We're going to toss it to... I don't have anything
Mad
for
Mike.
Him. Mad Mike. That's what he gets. He's got a bit to talk about.
The magnificent...
We tried.
No, we tried. I tried giving him an entrance.
It's
failed.
It's Mad Mike.
Fuck it.
Anthony's Minute of Mayhem. Raise motherfucker, raise the hell out
of night. Greetings, Mayhemers. It's Mad Mike once again with your Minute of Mayhem. Raw was a really great show tonight. You know, if you don't count the last 20 minutes. Not to toot my own horn, but I'd like to think that I come up with better fake songs about wrestling than The Rock. The only good line he had was about Eve. He can't make up his mind if Cena is gay or if Cena has lady parts. Because he uses both jokes, and using both jokes doesn't stick to the same stick, and it doesn't work. I don't know how you ruin Freddie Mercury, but somehow The Rock did it. So I guess he's pretty impressive with that regard. But as far as everything else, Raw was fucking amazing. The Jericho promo about CM Punk was just phenomenal. It was absolutely tremendous. And again, it illustrates the difference, you know, with how Jericho interacts in the modern promo and how Rock interacts in the modern promo. Rock was a little bit better this time, I will give him that. Especially compared to the last couple weeks he's been on, but Cena's rap was fucking amazing. I mean, first he came out to basic Thuganomics, which was awesome. He had the chain, the lock, the retro jersey, all that shit. It was throwback. It was amazing. And see, the problem is, though, I know we all want Cena to return to that guy, but I think if he came out and did it every week again, it would just get stale. Because when he did it, when he first started, he was trying to build himself up. Now he doesn't need to do that. He only needs to do it when he needs to get serious. I don't know about the 12-man thing. I think it's kind of stupid, but it does get everyone on WrestleMania. I wonder if they did this because Wade Barrett was supposed to win Money in the Bank at Mania. That's my guess. I'm going to stick to that. And since Wade Barrett's out there, like, okay, let's just throw everyone into Money in the Bank. Because if you look... That's a lot of Money in the Bank contenders. R-Truth, Kofi, Dolph, Swagger, the whole nine yards. And I think the Zack Ryder, Eve, Beth Phoenix thing could have some potential if they actually run with that to WrestleMania. All right, well, that's it for me, guys. Take care. Spike your hair. You know it.
Thanks, Mad Mike, for that Minute of Mayhem. Now, I think there are a few disagreements amongst the Peanut Gallery, LBNU.
A few.
LB, well, I think you had the first one.
I will say his exact words were talking about Cena coming out in the chain and all that. And he said, we all want him to go back to being that guy. Fuck that. And fuck you. I never, ever, 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 ever want to see Cena do that.
No. I got to say, I'm a fan of basic Thuganomics. I will be listening to that album all week. I'm probably going to put it on while I edit this show tonight. And I appreciated him coming out and going back to that. I think that was a good homage to what he used to be there. And
I don't want him to be
Thuganomics completely.
Because he was still wearing his John Cena Never Give Up wristbands.
Well, whatever.
It doesn't matter. He has to promote something.
Case closed.
No, you have your own guy.
What case did you close? Wrestle fan, let me tell you about a friend of mine named Natalie who started drinking.
No, hold on. I want to see where this goes.
Is there more to the story? We're all hanging, LB.
So that's it. Well, she started drinking to fit in with the popular kids. But she had to sell wristbands too. She started. Nothing sells wristbands like swilling vodka. Okay.
Wait.
So if John Cena really wants to sell wristbands, he'll also sell delicious John Cena brand vodka. Make all the cool kids like you, or at least get them so drunk that they don't notice how ugly they are when they're fucking you.
I think the case is closed now.
Case closed. Yeah, now, case closed. Now it's appropriate to say case closed.
Okay. Okay. And what else did he talk about that we disagreed with? Because I can't remember.
Well, there's one point I can't remember.
I'm stuck on that.
He was wrong a lot. But yeah. No.
There was one point that I agree with him on, and that's the fact that the only reason they're doing the 12 man is to get everyone on the show.
Well, yeah, it is, actually. Yeah, Rizz, what are you saying?
I remember talking about this in the Hangout last night. This whole thing with Eve and Beth Phoenix, it's the exact same thing they've been doing, but only switching the heels and the faces. So you're going to have Eve and you're going to have Beth Phoenix face each other at WrestleMania. But Beth is the good guy, girl. And
Remember when Natalya was all tough and cool and friends with Beth Phoenix, and then she got the farts?
That's what happens, become friends with Beth Phoenix. You get the farts. Yeah. That's exactly why I don't hang out with LB anymore.
You drink a lot of vodka so that the cool Beth Phoenix becomes your friend, and then you get the vodka farts, and nobody likes vodka farts.
No, I don't care how Canadian you are. Wow.
Bring it back, Sorg. Bring it back.
So I think the Mayhem Show needs a new lawyer, especially after some of that conversation that just happened.
Yes.
So you can tweet at David Atunga. He is your lawyer, just like Matt Stryker was your teacher. I'm thinking David Atunga, your lawyer.
David Atunga is such an amazing person. Does he get in the WWE ring every night? Not only does he, you know, he's out in the press doing stuff with Be a Star, but he does law jobs on Twitter.
This dude is a fucking law job.
You have been in a car accident or any kind of accident, you may be entitled to compensation. Tweet David Otunga at David Otunga and get the money you deserve. Mr. Otunga doesn't get paid unless you get paid.
Yep, you there, you Twitter account, you there you go. There you go, at David Otunga.
Way to rip off Edgar Snyder.
No, well, I don't think he's the only one that does that. That's more of a regional thing, I think.
That's more
like how there's an ad on the side of it of an actual lawyer.
Wait, is there? Hold on, let me pop that up there. Law offices of, yes, there is. Hold on, and he's local too. yes, Mr. Frank C. Walker, Pittsburgh criminal defense.
Your real attorney,
real fucking attorney. Available 24/7.
David has nothing on Edgar Snyder.
There you go. We should call this guy right now.
Listen.
If you're watching right now, call that number on the video and give him a call. Tell him the Wrestling Mayhem Show just gave him a plug. Pay us.
Hey, speaking of calling, do we still have that Wrestling Feds number?
I don't know. It's on the internet somewhere. Otunga Worship Part 2? What?
Does anybody know what they were called?
I can't remember. So I think this should be a little bit of exercise. Does anybody have any legal advice that they want to tweet David Otunga, attorney at law? Has anybody had any tips lately?
Lunchbox?
It's just a lunchbox. You will have need for a lawyer. Go. Shit, that's hard.
I dropped my sandwich inside of the restaurant and they wouldn't give me a new one.
Ooh, you know what? Yeah, restaurant. You fucking got it, all right? I went to a restaurant, all right? This really legitimately, no lie, happened to me in real life. I went to a restaurant. I choked on my food. I almost died. I was doing this saying, oh, I'm fucking choking. Someone save me. They didn't do a goddamn thing, so I threw up in the middle of their floor. Not only did they not try and help me, not one person tried to help me, they fucking – They charged me for my full meal, which I didn't eat and couldn't take with me because it was a buffet. And they said, here, have some tea. It'll make you feel better after being sick. I said I wasn't sick. I choked. They put the tea on my table and fucking charged me for it. I'd like to sue them within an inch of their lives.
Was it Golden Corral?
No. No, it wasn't. But I heard a Golden Corral story, which is also gross. No. No, it was... I don't know where it's
all right, all right, all right, Albie. Now you need to drop that down to 140 characters. And tweet Mr. David Otunga.
Choked in. Okay, I'm going to do this shit.
Do this right now, and we'll retweet it on the Mayhem Show account so everybody can see.
In a buffet, they gave me tea. That's your tweet.
And then charge me for it.
And then charge those fucks.
And again, anybody out there, please, if you're listening, tweet David Otunga your law.
Is it at David Otunga?
At David Otunga, Otunga.
We know.
I'm just making sure. I don't know. He says a lot of Tonga. You know. I don't know. No. Seriously, tweet David Otunga your law stuff. Retweet it to Mayhem Show or email it to us or something. We want to see what you guys have out there, and we want to see if it responds to anybody. I responded last night and said, "Hey, Mayhem Show may need a lawyer." I didn't get any response yet, so hit that
He's
up.
A busy man.
Let's see what. Let's have some fun with this. You know, they put that out there. I mean, come on, that is glorious. What is this guy getting right now? I'm actually wondering. I wonder if I can do a quick Twitter search on him.
As we fill.
Filler. Let's see. Somebody wants to know what the charge would be if David Tunga filed his LLC for him. Let's see. Begging from The Voice Rises, begging your pardon, David Tunga. I'm going bald because of my father's DNA. Do I have a case?
Uh-huh. Oh man, what a loser.
And he listens to the show.
Wow.
Does he really?
I don't know. Here we go. Rowdy Marty Piper adds him.
What a loser.
Please help my neighbor. Please help. My neighbor made sweet love to my mailbox and got interesting stains on my new lawnmower manual Cub Cadet sent me. What?
Oh, dear.
That guy is definitely a loser.
Listen, guys, it's time I tell you about my thing for mailboxes.
Moving on. Wow.
I did my tweet is out there. It's there now.
It is out there, so I will pass this along here. So.
At David Otunga. Choked in restaurant. No one tried to help. Almost died. Still got charged for a meal I didn't eat plus tea I didn't ask for. Help!
All caps with the help?
Just
an exclamation.
Oh, what a loser.
I love it. Hey, you don't talk about DJ Sauce in the Box like that.
Sauce Box.
I talk about whoever I want, whenever I want, fuckface.
Whoa.
Wrestle fan, that's a defamation suit. You need to tweet David Otunga.
Chachi, I'm taking your ass to court.
Tweet him. Go for it, man.
I will see you there, dickhead.
Ask if you can sue for emotional scarring from the Mayhem Show crew. No, not the Mayhem Show crew.
How do you spell derogatory?
Let Twitter figure it out.
You're in college.
You are in college.
You should at least know how to use Google.
Hey. Be sure to tell him I called you an asshat also, asshat.
Oh, shit. That reminds me, I need to follow him. Wait, what is this? What is this? What's this, Rizz?
What?
You tweeted and you didn't even tell us.
Question.
Huh?
It is a legit question.
What did you ask him?
Can I sue Levi's if I caught my member in a zipper?
That's tremendous. Tremendous.
Oh, I need to check on my hater.
Your hater?
Yeah.
Oh, doesn't have AD.
No, it doesn't. It just reminded me that I need to check on my hater.
We'll check on that for the ender there. All right, what else is going on in wrestling? Oh, hey, there's a new sex tape out. I'm sure wrestle fans watched it.
Oh, no.
Yeah. Wait. No. So, Rizz, I think you were following this developing story. What were you doing? What are you doing?
Wrestle.
By the way, tweet sent. Co-worker makes derogatory remarks, calls me an asshat and fuckface on a daily basis, preventing me from doing my job.
That guy just threw on the ground.
What'd you just do?
I just threw my Hulk Hogan wrestle buddy to the ground.
Is it done for you?
Shame.
Is your hero dead?
Rizz is going to make an all-new sex tape.
Hey, Rizz.
Yeah.
If you send that to WrestleFan, I'm sure he'll make good use out of it. Oh,
what?
I said if you send that
what?
To I said if you send that to WrestleFan, I'm sure he'll get some good use out of it.
Oh yeah.
Inspired by true events. Oh, my God. So yeah, Hulk Hogan, there's a sex tape out there. It's being shopped around. He can't identify the woman in there because he slept with so many damn women after he got divorced. Where do we start with this?
I don't think we do.
This is kind of
I'd like to start. I'd like to have a little speculation as to what this tape is going to look like.
I don't want to have nightmares tonight.
Okay, so imagine this, if you will. Okay?
No! I don't want to.
Chachi, you all imagine.
Imagine a poorly carved pumpkin.
No.
No.
Hold on.
No.
2 to 3 weeks after Halloween. No. So it's all bitter and puckered, okay? And it's got, it's like, it's really round on the bottom, and it has one of those, like, motorized mice that do this, and so the pumpkin just kind of, like, gently and awkwardly rolls around a lot. Now put a mustache on it.
Blonde
mustache, dark beard. He's the heel. It's heel and Hogan.
And a skull.
Dark beard, blonde mustache.
Don't forget the
skull. What's that?
Don't forget the skull.
Gotta have the skullet. Always stopping every few minutes to fix the bandana, right? You're gonna have a steady stream of commentary from Brutus the Barber Beefcake, who clearly filmed it.
Okay. Oh, man.
And I'm gonna end this. I'm gonna end this by saying, it's gotta be like a combination of like, high pulp orange juice that's gone bad and cod liver oil, and I'm just gonna leave it at that.
I wonder if
milk mixed in.
Oh man.
I wonder if every time that she calls him daddy, he goes like this.
I didn't see what you did.
You didn't get it on video.
That's
great,
me.
Sorg.
It's a video. What? What?
I'll do the joke again. I wonder if every time she calls him daddy, he goes like this.
Sonic says that the tape will have ripping and a lot of hand to ears. Punk is with the Fu Manchu. Gene Okerlund cries out halfway through. Somebody get in there and help him. Wheels, what you gonna do when Hulkamania? Hot Wheels says, and I gotta do this in the voice.
Right,
what
there.
You gonna do when Hulkamania comes all over you? Oh God. Wow.
Add orange juice and cod liver oil.
The worst thing is that we were making these same jokes when China had the wrestling sex tape come out when she has the leg lock on Hulk Hogan.
I never saw it, but imagine China's sex tape. One night in
China. I've seen it.
You seen it?
Yeah, I watched it.
Why do you say that so proudly?
Yeah.
Because he survived.
Yeah, I did. I'm still alive to talk about it.
It's like being a
damn. Let him go.
200 more pounds. And a slightly bigger penis.
Slightly.
And notice I didn't say Sean Waltman's and not in this one. He's probably filming the damn tape.
I'm curious to see it just to see all the like horrible scars that have got to crisscross Hulk Hogan's old wrinkled pumpkin body. Well, he's been a wrestler a long time and had a lot of surgery. He's got to be like fucking Batman, just coated in scars.
In the TMZ report, they said that you can actually see the defined tan line.
Stop it.
On the, the lady? Please say it's on the lady.
No.
No, it's on...
it's on him.
Wow.
I'm going to go puke at lunch.
I'm kind of curious to see the lady, you know, right just...
Yeah, I want to see...
Right there?
I want to see what caliber of... what caliber of chick...
Is
80-year-old Hulk Hogan can pick up.
Exactly. It's the one he's marrying, like 26 or something ridiculous. Yeah. I mean, that's weird. Yeah.
Age doesn't mean anything.
No, it doesn't.
I want to see the caliber of female. I hope it's a female.
That Hulk Hogan. Oh, wouldn't it be great if it was a dude?
What? Okay, well, first of all, I mean, is this like you think, okay, all right.
I didn't mean to fluster you that much. I'm sorry.
Turn the tangents. Oh my gosh.
There's been the rumors by Linda and all them about Hogan's homosexuality. I'm wondering if this is, you know, knowing Hogan, it's like, oops, I let this out there just to prove he wasn't gay.
It's the penis poke of death. That's what it is.
Oh my god.
That's your show title and the show title of the freaking sex tape.
Penis book of death.
I'm gonna go vomit now. I don't
think you can post that, can you?
No, I can't. Not gonna do it.
I like how I brought the whole show to the halt.
Right. Done.
I think the only way we can follow this up is with Rizz reenacting the sex tape with his wrestle buddy.
Oh dear. Oh, he's getting
it. Don't do it. Oh my god.
Hold on. We have to announce this because we do have audio listeners. Oh no. Oh, he's pushing. He's got this. No, go back on. Pushing it down. Pushing the head of the wrestle buddy down. Further. Oh no, he's looking. Oh no, he's back down. Oh, he's back. Oh dear, Hogan is. Oh, he's. What am I? I feel so gross.
You know what I'd buy? You know what I would buy? I would pay money for it if it was the Wrestle Buddy fucking the chick. I'd pay for it. I'm sorry. That would be entertaining.
I would see that.
Well, local radio friends of us. radio host on the Freak Show.
Yes.
Had a conversation about how much, because they found out about it, and of course they talked about it.
Of course they talked about it.
And Mikey said, I'd pay good money to see that. And this was an in-depth conversation, to which Bob responded, what are we talking, like $10? $5? And Mikey's like, no, I'd pay a whole $50 to see this sex tape.
$350.
Now is Mikey an admitted Hulk Hogan fan from back in the day?
Yes.
So yeah.
Why would he do that though? Ruin your childhood? Just ski all over your childhood?
Yeah. It's been long gone for me at this point. And this was the final nail in the coffin. I don't think I can go back and watch like a Hulk Hogan match now.
How much like an old WCW match do you think the sex tape is?
If we want to talk about those really bad ones with like the Yeti.
The Yeti.
Didn't we talk about one time how Billy Kidman knows what
five moves in bed too?
No, what I wanna know is, alright, the guy is used to making an entrance. when a camera is rolling. No, seriously.
And also, he never does the job.
Yes. I want to know. What I want to know.
Wait, did you just see that, though?
What?
You see my wrestle buddy? He was reenacting the sex tape.
What I want to know is if he hit the music. I want to know if he came into Real American.
Was there pyro?
He is a showman.
He's wearing the boas. There's the music. Hits his music.
He's standing.
You think he came in for the save?
He's. No. No. No, seriously. What I want to know, I want to know if he was at the bedroom door, and he was calling it the gorilla position, and he was waiting.
Gorilla press.
He was waiting for that one part in the music that really gets him going before he kicked in the door and just ran around the room doing the ear thing, and then he hopped up on the bed, ripped off the shirt, and just plowed into the chair.
Chachi's done. Chachi's tapped out.
Did he come out to a real American?
Yeah, that's a big difference, because nothing kills the mood like that shitty Hulkamania real American song from WCW.
It was in between his divorce. And he's, you know, Linda had just left him. He had to be the heel. He was feeling all dark. Had to be the Hendrix. Shitty fucking Fu Manchu, man. Just like that.
Can we stop talking about Hulk
Hogan? I have to disagree. Honestly, I think, unless he's date raping a chick.
Whoa!
I'm pretty sure.
Refer back to the Wolf's email?
I'm pretty sure he's a face in the bedroom.
That's a good question. You know, that should go in an eHarmony questionnaire. Are you a face or a heel?
Did he use a foreign object?
Sometimes the captain.
And finally, the last thing to end this off, and then let's move on from here. Did he bleed? Okay, ladies and gentlemen, what else happened out there this week in the world of wrestling? I tell you what, I apparently put nothing else except the Hulk Hogan sex tape in the show notes.
That's how it goes.
Well, that's a good show. Good job, guys.
I have to say, I want to thank Hulk Hogan for having sex with a lady on tape, because it has given us more material. The WWE Network.
You just had a cameo.
I
did have a cameo.
other than the my whole things that are more interesting than
John Laurinaitis.
John Laurinaitis
is pretty up there on the scale.
Yeah, this is joke material.
There it is. All right, guys. Is there anything else you want to discuss here? I think it's time to learn what we learned.
Is there anything else that we can discuss here?
We can't follow it up. All right, from there, guys, I want to know what you learned.
Wheel said that he wants to know if he hawks up when he busts a load.
He yells, brother.
Brother.
Wow. Scott Hall and Kevin Nash held her down while he... Whoa.
Too far.
Was it a lumberjack match? All right, that's enough. But guys, let's move around.
Does he rip a condom instead of his t-shirt?
Yeah.
Do you think he laid down to relinquish the belt? The belt being his penis.
I wonder if he has creative control.
No, that's Kevin Nash.
Oh, that's right. Hey, WrestleFan, let me know what you learned from wrestling this week.
Do you think he put her over?
No.
I can't help it. I'm on a roll.
I learned from wrestling this week that it really is an issue in arenas all across America that they don't have vegan cuisine in their concession stands. That's the plight that Daniel Bryan had to face last night on Raw.
Okay. Excellent. Riz, what did you learn from wrestling this week?
Ow.
I don't know.
even in the bedroom,
pass.
Hulk Hogan doesn't put anyone over.
But I learned that Hogan was not nor a heel nor a face in this situation. But he did.
He's the victim.
Head.
I'm sorry, what?
He did get head.
I'm waiting for the Al Snow. The Al Snow.
Does everybody want?
Yeah. Yes. I want the Al Snow sex tape.
What'd you learn, sir?
No, what?
I said I'm waiting on the Al Snow sex tape.
No, wait. Let's go around the room here. What sex tape do you want?
Oh, wait. If you had to pick a sex tape.
Oh, man.
If you had to pick a sex tape.
Wait, hold on.
Are we going to all pick divas?
Wait, hold on. No. Male or female?
Explicitly, are you curious what would happen if this guy had a sex tape?
It has to be classic WWF.
Oh, man.
Nice.
And go.
And go.
Oh, you want me to start?
Yeah, you go ahead.
Yeah,
you start.
Go for it.
Set the tone.
The Iron Sheik.
Oh, dude, that'd be hilarious.
You win. You just won.
You make them humble.
It doesn't get any better than that, man. You just trumped us all.
You're welcome.
It does get better than that.
Well, how does it get better than that?
The Brooklyn Brawler. You know what? That's. I can tell you what that sex tape would be. It would be 2 minutes long. He would come into the room, wouldn't be able to get it up. Credits.
Wait, you know what?
Credits.
I have one.
All right, WrestleFan.
It's a dark horse. Two words. Ahmed Johnson.
Yeah, that's already
what?
Been done.
Oh, that would be ridiculous. It's just him shouting and beating something.
It's the only,
and then he gets angry and notices the camera and punches it, and that's the end.
It's the only sex tape in the history of sex tape that is only one person.
All right, LB, do you have one?
I do. And just to see if it would take place the way it would in my mind.
He's going to say Dark the Clown?
No, because I don't ever want to think of that. I would love to see one of Vincent Kennedy McMahon.
There you go.
I'm sure they exist.
That's probably
because I want angry Vince. I want those images to be true to life.
All right.
I thought of another good one. Go ahead.
Okay, no. Go ahead.
Ultimate Warrior.
Yeah, I want to know. Also, I'm sure exists.
I want to know if he attacks the headboard like he did the ropes when he comes in.
All right, I got one, and this is it. This is our what I learned for this week. I got one last one, and I hope this is legal. Rizz, you can make the call on this.
Okay.
Bushwhackers.
Yes. That works.
They just be licking everything.
Some
from
question.
From the chat room, Sonic Screwjob mentions the Great Khali.
Great what?
No.
No,
great,
Bobby.
No, it works because the Great Khali is eternal.
Bobby F.J. Yeah. Towns is the best. Norman Smiley.
That's right.
Virgil.
Yes.
Virgil?
Yep.
He won't stop talking.
No, what happens is...
There is no Virgil
sex
tape.
Nobody shows up.
No. What happens is he just shows up in someone else's sex tape and sits at the table.
Can we name this episode someone else's sex tape?
Oh my god. Guys, this has been Wrestling Mayhem Show. Go check us out at WrestlingMayhemShow.com. Twitter is at Mayhem Show with who you want to see in a sex tape.
Or email us
at goodtimes@wrestlingmayhemshow.com 412-206 WMS09670. Guys, this is Zork. Please let us know what you want to see in a sex tape. I don't know if we can get much better than that. For Chachi, for Rizz, for the Wrestle Buddy, for LB, for WrestleFan, thanks, Biss, for joining us. It was a great interview. Check out Anarchy Championship Wrestling. We'll see you guys next week. Mayhem Show, out! Just wait.